everybody, and welcome to this latest edition of Breaking Down Barriers. This is a series that we are focusing on different stigmas around Huntington's disease, which includes both research and scientific stigmas, as well as social stigmas. And today, we are so excited to have some amazing folks to chat with us a little bit about a topic that you might have heard a lot about recently, and that is the topic around genetic modifiers. And so we have a panel of experts and an ambassador to share a little bit about the conversation that's happening around those around genetic modifiers in general and how that might impact Huntington's disease families. So I would like to start off by inviting our first guest to introduce herself, Dr. Nayana Lahiri.
Hi, everyone. My name is Nayana. I'm a clinical geneticist at St. George's Hospital in London. I have been part of the HD community since 2007, when I started doing some research with Professor Tabrizi at UCLH in London, working on a study called TRACK-HD. And since then, I've been working with families with Huntington's disease, primarily in sort of genetic counselling for people who are thinking about having genetic testing themselves. And I've maintained an interest in genetic modifiers and what the genetic test result might mean for people and the support that might be available to them afterwards. So I'm a trustee for the UK Huntington's Disease Network, and I chair the Predictive Testing Consortium in England and the Genetic Testing and Counselling Working Group for the European Huntington's Disease Network.
That's amazing. Thank you so much for being here. And you'll hear from our two experts in this area. They're kind of a big deal. So we're excited to have you here today. I'd also like to introduce Dr. Tom Massey.
Oh, hi, everyone. I'm Tom Massey. I'm a neurologist here in Cardiff in the UK. And I'm also a scientist. So my background was in researching DNA repair processes. And then as I did my clinical training in medicine, I became very interested in neurodegeneration and particularly in Huntington's disease, having met lots of patients in clinic. And I now research genetic modifiers. I'm the co-chair of the European HD Network Genetic Modifiers Working Group. My lab works on different genetic modifiers, and I try to apply those findings to our HD clinic, which runs downstairs in the same building each week.
Fantastic. Thanks so much for being here. And last but certainly not least, representing the Huntington's disease community, one of our ambassadors, Rhiannon Ireland.
Thank you. Hello, everybody. So my name's Rhiannon. HD has been a constant in my life, with my mother being diagnosed actually during my birth. So I grew up with my father caring for my mother for about 10 years before she actually went into the care in a local community hospital, for 5 years before passing away. I honestly can't remember a time where HD wasn't a part of my life, or that it wasn't. I was extremely aware of my risk of inheriting HD. So at the age of 23, I actually decided to get tested, and I did find out that I was positive for the gene. And then, so since then, I've actually taken quite an active role. I would say I've always attended my HD enroll appointments every year. I've actually taken part in studies such as Move Wales and DRUM. And this year I've actually become an ambassador of HDYO, which I'm very proud of. And I'm really trying to raise the flag, so to say, fly the flag. But it's because I wanted to be more involved with the HD community. It's a lovely community. I'm really enjoying being a part of it. I'm hoping to raise awareness amongst not just the HD community, but also the wider community as well. And also, I'm here to improve my knowledge of recent developments. So this opportunity here today, I'd just like to say thank you, Jenna, for facilitating it. So thank you.
Yeah, so happy to have you here with us. And it's such an important conversation, and we love to be able to involve the community in this conversation because we get to understand what the education level is, what the knowledge is, and see how we can better communicate these different important topics. So thank you so much for being here. Well, I want to pick on Tom and Nayana a little bit, because we always like to ask this really important question. That's really, how did you become focused in Huntington's disease? What inspired you to get connected with this community through your work?
Shall I take this first? Well, I always knew that I wanted to sort of be a doctor. And so I went to medical school, and my medical school is at St. George's in London, which is actually where I work now. And I think that the HD gene was sort of identified in the year or two before I started medical school. And so there was a lot of you know, conversation about it, and a lot of, you know, that was pretty much the only gene that people talked about in terms of our sort of studying genetics at university. And I did an undergraduate degree in genetics alongside my medical degree. And I got to sit with some amazing people in clinic who inspired me to become a clinical geneticist. And one of them ran the HD clinic here at St. George's at the time. And so I sort of was focused a little bit on you know, trying to sort of follow a similar path from that stage. And I was really lucky to be able to work with Professor Tabrizi at UCLH doing my research degree. And that's really when I sort of met people with Huntington's disease or at risk of Huntington's disease, and was really sort of quite blown away by the HD community and sort of, you know, how small, but also how close it is. And you know, that sort of solidified why I wanted to carry on working in this field.
That was, yeah, very interesting, Nayana. So my motivation is quite similar, but maybe came in a different order. So I, from school, always wanted to be a research scientist, and I was particularly interested in genetics. And Huntington's being a genetically defined neurodegeneration, it sort of was ripe for interesting disease-focused work and investigation. But actually, my PhD work was on bacteria, looking in completely different systems in bugs. I was looking at genes in bugs, and this was great. It was fun, and I enjoyed doing that. But then I wanted to apply that to human disease. And so I went to medical school after my research degree. And during that time, I found neurology really interesting, seeing patients in the clinic. And I wanted to research conditions where I thought I could potentially make a difference. And in neurology, there are lots of disorders that are very difficult to treat. And but Huntington's, because we knew the genetic basis of it, seemed that there would be a possibility to do that. So about 10 years ago now, I started working in HD. And that's mostly with Professor Anne Roster, who's another clinical neurologist here in Cardiff, and Professor Leslie Jones, who is a geneticist here in Cardiff. And so I work together with them, they're my mentors, and develop projects around genetic modifiers in Huntington's that we're really excited to try and take forward towards clinical trials and eventually, hopefully, therapeutics. So I've really enjoyed being part of the community. As Nayana said, it's quite small, it's very collaborative, which is nice. That's not always the case in science or in clinical research, and that makes a big difference when you're trying to get big projects going. And the fact we have registry and that now enroll has really sort of kick-started all the work that I'm involved in.
No, that's so amazing. I think it's so important to hear from you all about your background, because I think sometimes it gets a little bit intimidating for community members to see scientists at different conferences. And it's important to understand how passionate both of you are about working with this community and the important impacts of that. So thank you so much for sharing that with us. I wanted to start this conversation. I wanted to really start with some of the basics around Huntington's disease. So can one of you share and remind us a little bit about the HD gene and how this the HD gene starts to progress and show symptoms within individuals? Can you share a little bit more about those schematics within that?
So we all have two copies of the HD gene. Everybody has two copies of it. And the gene is important in sort of growth and development and normal brain function. And so it is important that everybody has two functioning copies of the gene. It is only when one copy of the gene has a particular genetic alteration in it that somebody might be at risk of developing Huntington's disease. And the way that that works is that in the very first bit of the gene, there is a little bit of the gene that is repeated over and over and over again. And that's the same in everybody. Everybody has a repeat within the first bit of their gene. You will have heard of it as a triplet repeat or a CAG repeat or a repeat. And it's only when that repeat is expanded above the normal limit that somebody might be at risk of developing Huntington's disease. So it is normal to have a CAG repeat size of up to 24. So some people might have one copy of the gene that has 12 and one copy of the gene that has 16. Some people might have 18 and 21, but it's only when one of the copies of your gene has more than 40 CAG repeats that you will be at risk of developing Huntington's disease during your lifetime. But it's a bit more complicated than that.
Yeah, and I think that's where this conversation comes into play, that it's important to start with that basic level to make sure everybody's on the same page to really understand how this builds off of this important conversation. So now, love to know, in general, what is a genetic modifier?
Yeah, I'll take this one. So as Nayana said, in general terms, if you have a CAG repeat of 36 or more repeats in one copy of your Huntington gene, that puts you at risk of Huntington's disease during your lifetime. And we know from looking at thousands of patients and their CAG repeat lengths that longer repeats are associated with earlier onset of disease symptoms. So they might be involuntary movements or mood problems or irritability and so on. And so the longer repeat that you inherit, in general, the earlier the symptoms start. But there is a massive amount of variation. So you might inherit 40 CAG repeats, and on average, your disease symptoms might start in middle age, so maybe in your 50s or something like that. But actually, if you look across thousands of Huntington's patients, actually, the disease symptoms can start any time from childhood, early adulthood, all the way through middle age to even old age. And that's with a single CAG repeat length. And so that large variation, some of that is down to the environment you live in and the background and so on. And some of it is down to other genes elsewhere. So we all have about 20,000 genes that work in different ways to determine who we are and how we function, how our brains work and so on. But we all have a lot of differences in those 20,000 genes. And it's those differences between individuals that can affect when the Huntington's disease symptoms start and also how they progress. And so we call those other genes, so the genes that are not the Huntington gene, the ones that affect the onset of disease, we call those genetic modifiers. And they're of particular interest because if we can understand those modifier genes and how they affect the onset of disease and the progression of disease, then maybe we can target them with drugs that would then slow onset or even prevent onset.
Thank you for that.
I'm just going to sort of add in something to what Tom said, if that's all right. So one of the main questions that people come to see us when they're thinking about having a predictive test for Huntington's disease is, if I have inherited the gene, at what age will I develop symptoms, or what's going to happen next? And I think that, even within a family, If we see somebody who has 40 CAG repeats, for example, and we know that lots of other people in the family have had this, have had that same repeat size, it is completely impossible to know when symptoms are going to start and how they're going to start and what they're going to look like over time. So, you know, lots of people will say, well, what does it mean if I have 40 CAG repeats? And I can never tell anybody that you're going to develop symptoms at the age of 55 or 65 or 35 or 45. And so, you know, that's part of that's where the genetic modifiers and the environmental modifiers become really important.
Yeah.
If I can jump in there, I think that's a really important point, because I think there was a misconception in the community for a little while, and I can say this when I was going through my genetic testing even, that there was a misconception that if you're, say for example, me and my mum have the same CAG repeat, I would then develop my symptoms at the same time as her. So and obviously that's, sometimes that can be a lot sooner than you want it to be. So it's nice to hear that this isn't necessarily the case, and it's very encouraging. So yeah, it's nice that it's not, the misconception isn't the same. Yeah. That makes sense.
No, I think that's important. And I was going to bring that up too. It's that it gets really easy to compare. And I think the troubling thing about Huntington's disease is that it is easy to compare, because you do have other family members who are impacted. So it's easy to look exactly like Rhiannon said about CAG repeat and age of onset. Especially, I think that this is not especially, but this is also really important to the people who are in the gray area of CAG repeats, because you do have people who develop symptoms in the gray area. And I think that this could be a further understanding of why some develop symptoms when statistically, and I want to really emphasize that statistics are just ideas based off of numbers, but we're all individuals. And so you have cases on each side, but statistically those within the gray area, if they develop symptoms again, tend to be a little bit older, but some don't. And so I think that this is an interesting piece of the puzzle to answer some of those questions that really can impact the community. So I'm curious, Rhiannon, from your perspective, why did you want to be a part of this conversation? While this is a topic that's been researched for years, in the last year or so, it's really become a topic that the community is hearing about. So why is this something that you wanted to learn more about in this conversation?
I think that with it being so current in research at the moment, I think it's imperative that we talk about having the HD community involved in these conversations. So I think this breaking down barriers session is ultra important for this, because speaking of someone who's had a BSc, it might be okay for me, like I've got a research background, a little bit of a research background. I can perhaps read the research papers a little bit easier than other people who may not have the same background. However, there are things that I do find very, well, a barrier, and like in my understanding of that research paper. So in coming to this today and having both of you and your knowledge and your expertise and for you to explain what do these modifications mean for us and how maybe it helps us to understand then what we're actually reading. Because there's a lot of fancy terminology that they put down in the research papers, because obviously they're expecting that level of understanding to already be there for the reader, but it's not always necessarily the case. Even in conferences, I felt that sometimes it's not brought down enough to the layperson, perhaps, and it's not for everybody's education level. So yeah, I think it's really important to have these conversations, and I want to learn more about it so I can understand more when I'm reading papers.
I think that's really important. And, you know, having this kind of format with conversational pieces really tries to do that, so we can have these open conversations and bring the different insights into this. I know you mentioned a little bit about how this could impact people with HD. I wanted to explore that a little bit more. What are your hopes a little bit more for this understanding within the community of how this could impact the HD community? It could be something within hopes for encouragement of going through genetic testing, you know, so what are you hoping that this information will provide the HD community from a scientific perspective?
A personal perspective, it just means that like, we're not so concerned about the statistics, et cetera, that are out there, and like maybe that we understand what the science behind the statistics and what it means. So it's just that we're not so anxious about these numbers or these CAG repeats, etc. We can, there's maybe might things that we might be able to, there might be science that comes about that we can understand why these, what these modifiers do. Is there any way treatments, etc., that we can do beforehand to help us then, so that we can push the age of onset onwards? That's what I'm hoping for. I don't know about you guys, but yeah, that's my hope.
So, could I ask you a question, Rhiannon?
Yeah.
So do you find it helpful or not helpful to know your CAG repeat lengths when you went through testing? What was that discussed with you, and did that have an impact?
I think it's, as I said, it was just, I think it was the old sort of version of thinking about the CAG repeats was the same as my mum. So the information that I was given was actually like factually incorrect at the time. Or it is now anyway. So it did affect me, because I was thinking, well, my mum got symptoms at 36 and I was 23. And I was like, well, that's 13 years before I get symptoms. And I was just like, well, I've got to go around the world. That's it. I've just got to go travel and I've got to speed everything up. But I'm quite a positive person. So that's like quite a good way to look at it. I was just like, all right, well, that just means I've just got to do things faster. But I suppose for other people, that might not necessarily be the case. It can be quite daunting at times, you know? So yeah, it is a major like factor, the CAG repeats, and like this whole thing about the age of onset. It is nerve wracking to hear those things sometimes.
And what I would say is that, you know, exactly as Tom said, at the moment, the impact of finding genetic modifiers is not to sort of be able to, is not going to be able to change the way that we speak to individual people about their individual risk and their timing of when they're going to develop Huntington's disease. It is much more about trying to understand how Huntington's disease happens and whether or not there are particular medications or developments of treatments that might help, because all of the research that has been done so far is on huge numbers of people, and all of those people are, you know, completely different from each other and individuals, so it cannot be applied on an individual basis. And so if you found out that you carried one of these modifiers, or if you were, you know, I don't think that we're there yet. And I think that's sometimes the message that comes across when people are talking about genetic modifiers, is that actually we are going to get an accurate ability to predict when one person is going to develop symptoms. And we are really, really far away from that in Huntington's and in a lot of other conditions too.
I think it's interesting because when Tom was mentioning genetic modifiers, he also mentioned some environmental factors. And one of the questions we got from our ambassadors is, do behavioral or lifestyle decisions or changes or what have you affect either the genetic modifiers or the disease progression in general? So I wanted to dive a little bit more into something along those lines.
Yeah, I think that's a really interesting question, actually. So I mean, certainly there's research to show that, you know, keeping physically and mentally active can certainly improve and maintain your, you know, quality of life and independence for longer in HD. And those factors are definitely important. Now, we don't know exactly how those factors are working, maybe, and it's possible, although I don't know of any evidence to show, it's possible that those things actually having an impact on what we call epigenetics, which is how genes are regulated in the body. But that's a very complex area of research that I don't think we have a particular handle on. But certainly what you do environmentally, by which you mean how you live your life, whether you healthy lifestyle and so on, those things can certainly have a big impact on your life. And I just pick up on a previous point about genetic modifiers. I think there's a misconception amongst the research community as well as the lay community about genetic modifier testing, in that all the work is done on tens of thousands of individuals, as Nayana said, and we use those really large populations to find these genetic modifiers, but really we're using those to understand the processes that are driving the disease on top of the Huntington's mutation. We're not using modifiers to then test individuals for those individual modifiers. That's not what we're doing. We use them as markers or signposts so that we know in the lab to go and research a particular area of brain biology that we can then understand the disease better.
Yeah, thank you for that explanation. So now looking specifically at modifiers in HD, what are some of the specific modifiers that are being researched right now to better understand?
Shall I do that one as well?
Why not? You should probably do that one.
Yeah, so it's a really interesting area of research, a really hot area. And yeah, there's a lot of research conferences that have a lot of their programs dedicated to genetic modifiers. And we've looked, and others have looked, in very large groups of patients and have found a number of factors that we think are important. So one is the actual sequence of the CAG repeat, the DNA around there. So as Nayana said, the repeat is repeating CAG units, so CAG, 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 CAG. And at the end of that, there's a normal sequence that comes afterwards. And we found that just at the end of the CAG repeat, there can be some really subtle spelling changes in the DNA. And those have been associated with much earlier or much later onset Huntington's. And so that's really interesting because that suggests that there's some factors in the DNA, in the repeat itself, that might have an impact on how the disease starts and progresses. The second area that we've looked at are factors or proteins in cells that are involved in DNA repair. And that's interesting because we know that the CAG repeat that causes Huntington's, you maybe inherit 40 repeats, for example. But we know that if you look in the brain, in some of the nerve cells in the brain, particularly in the areas that degenerate first, you find that those repeats have got even longer. And so they might go 50, 60, 100, 200, even 1,000 repeats in some cells. So we know that that process, what we call somatic expansion, we know that that process driving repeats to longer and longer lengths is quite variable in different people. And we have now identified various DNA repair factors that can influence that process. So we think that there are accelerators, so things that make that expansion in the brain cells go faster. And there are also brakes, so factors that can slow that process down. And so we can maybe, that's what the hope is, that we can target one or both of those types of factors to slow the disease. So you might want to have more of the brake that slows expansions down, and you might want to have a drug that inhibits or blocks the accelerators, which would have the same effect of slowing that somatic expansion down. So in broad terms, those are the genetic modifiers that we've now identified.
I just wanted to come back to the interruptions that Tom was talking about. And so I suppose that those are the ones that are most likely to perhaps be used on an individual basis in the future. And so I think it's important for us to think a little bit about that and what it might mean for certain people. And the group of people in whom it might be most relevant is those people who are in the grey area. So that is people who have what we call a reduced penetrance genetic alteration. So between 36 and 39 CAG repeats where you may or may not develop symptoms at some point during your lifetime. It may be. And so these interruptions, the changes in interruptions, so most people have a standard configuration. but there's about 2% of the population who might have an unusual configuration that might mean that they could develop symptoms at an earlier stage. And so in those people, if you were in the reduced penetrance range and you had this unusual configuration, then it might make you more likely that somebody in your family was going to develop symptoms.
And I, for those who may recall, we chatted with Dr. Rachel Harding and Dr. Leora Fox with HD Buzz about somatic instability and expansion back in November. So that that deep dive into somatic expansion is also available with our Breaking Down Barriers on YouTube to get some enhanced additional information as well. So I think that that's really important. So is it safe to say that now now that this information has been found, that there could be some links? What's happening on that would be more people facing for the science side of things? Are you seeing that there is more interest and further understanding and maybe potentially turning that into a phase one study coming down the pipeline?
Yes, so there's a lot of interest, both commercially and academically, in the processes that are underpinning genetic modifiers. So particularly, as you mentioned, somatic expansion, that's a really hot topic, and I'm glad you've done a deep dive on that elsewhere. But that's a really exciting area. So for example, MSH3 is one of these accelerators that you might have heard about. So we think that's a DNA repair protein that seems to be involved in driving repeat expansions to greater lengths. And we think that that's happening in the brain neurons that ultimately degenerate. So if we could target MSH3 with a drug, then we might be able to slow that process down. So there are various ways of doing that, and academic, so university labs and company labs are working on those things. For example, a typical, we call small molecule drugs, so a pill that you might take is then absorbed and gets to the brain and can then block MSH3. People are working on that. Other groups are working on things called antisense oligonucleotides, which are little bits of DNA that can bind specifically to your target, so in this case MSH3 messenger, and that would then degrade that and have the effect of lowering your MSH3 levels. So that's another way in which you might be able to target that, and that would be given through a lumbar puncture, rather like the tominersen Huntington lowering therapies that have been trialed recently. So that's just one example of how people are working towards phase one trials in these areas. And I'm hopeful that they will come through in the next few years. Yeah.
You mentioned this a little bit, but just curious, are people now that as people are participating in Enroll-HD and other studies where, I guess not necessarily Enroll, but other studies where there could be a blood draw or further genetic testing or as the people are going through genetic testing in general, is that how people are finding out about the prevalence of these modifiers, or how has this research been initiated to understand these large numbers of the population?
Yes. So a lot of the genetic association studies that have led to the identification of modifiers come from these large cohort studies. So there's Registry and then Enroll. They've underpinned a lot of the work. And then Track that Noina was involved with, which was a smaller group of individuals, but with a really broad range of deep testing. That is also really informative, for example, in the first identification of MSH3 as a driver of somatic expansion. And so, every individual who contributes a blood sample to any of these studies is making a contribution to these large genetic studies. So, for example, people who have given blood to a Huntington study 15 years ago or 10 years ago, you know, those blood tests and the DNA sequences that have come out of them are still being used today in large genetic studies, and they will continue to be used. And so, you know, those samples are absolutely invaluable. If we didn't have them, we wouldn't have been able to do any of the genetics.
Yeah, I think that's a really important point, because especially for the younger community, where you may not have the ability to participate in clinical trials for a multitude of reasons, participating in these studies, in observational studies, things like that are so crucial, because your information helps future knowledge of different things that maybe aren't even discovered or thought of right now, thinking about 15 years ago or what have you, but especially now. So I think participating in enroll, participating in these different observational studies that may be happening in your own backyard are hugely important. And so I think sometimes it can be easy to say, well, I can't do anything right now to help advance. There's so many ways, observational studies, surveys, registries, all of these things still are crucial because that information matters.
Yeah.
And it could be in the future that actually some of these genetic modifiers might help us to know who would be the best people to be in a clinical trial at a particular stage or a particular age, because the aim is that, you know, all of these therapies we're going to want to deliver before somebody is symptomatic, so that we can prevent symptoms or slow down the progression of onset and symptoms over time. And so so nobody wants to be on a toxic, potentially toxic drug for 20 or 30 years before they're going to develop symptoms. And so being able to know what your genetic modifier profile might mean about the potential of you developing symptoms at a particular stage is going to be really important for knowing when somebody might be the right time for somebody to be on a therapy.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, Rhiannon, I'm curious, you know, what was your level of understanding about genetic modifiers coming in, and what do you think the community understands in general?
I think, well, from my experience, I've done a little bit of reading on the expansion, but that was more a curiosity. And I saw the video that you were referring to earlier, Jenna. But that was the limit of it. And in terms of the community, I think unless you've been to a conference or unless you're searching for these papers, I don't think that it's so like known about in the wider community, and like to the layperson perhaps. I think sometimes when we come in for the like these different sort of like appointments for the HD community, sometimes these things are mentioned, but sometimes it's difficult to comprehend in those appointments. So actually getting a sit down beer has been really worthwhile and has really improved my level of understanding. So I am really appreciative to you, to Tom and Nayana, for your time today. So I just, yeah, thank you very much for helping me understand a bit more about what could possibly be happening in the future with genetic modifiers, and hopefully slowing down the process.
Yeah. Can I ask you a question, Rhiannon, about what do you, I think it's really difficult to answer because everybody is going to have a completely different answer to this, but what do you think that people might want to know or might be useful to them when they're going through predictive testing in terms of, you know, the genetic information that we're able to get?
Sorry, can you reword that for me if that's okay? Sorry,
yeah,
that was just one year and went out the other.
So I think it's really difficult because every individual is going to have a different sort of perspective on this. But when you were being told about the genetics of Huntington's disease whilst you were having predictive testing, what would have been helpful information for you to sort of weigh up the pros and cons of having a genetic test in terms of CAG, in terms of what the genetic alteration means?
I think it would have been, I struggled with it more because I'm quite scientific minded, so I kind of wanted to sort of maybe have a little bit more, I'm not saying I wanted like research papers, but just something that would have like, you know, some sort of evidence-based discussion with me, because mine was very much very, very low level sort of conversation, and I didn't really, there wasn't really much explanation of what these CAG repeats meant. It was, you've got the same repeats as your mum, and like, this means that you will have it at some point in your life, which I understand that we can't say when or how, etc. But it just sort of a little bit more information on just the different sort of research that was going on, even something like that, that might have just been very helpful, like just to have a little bit a bit of hope, really, because I'd going through the process, it wasn't like it wasn't very uplifting, so to say. I know, what can you do? But I think having just some, maybe some research and stuff on it, and just informing us that obviously getting rid of the old stigmas of it's going to be the same age, and just reinforcing that, obviously, you know, this could be any sort of factors may sort of delay or may like put it off, or there's these new upcoming therapies. I think just having that maybe level of positivity towards it might have helped a little bit more. When, as someone who's seen it or like seen the whole process of Huntington's disease before, like I know the downsides, I was just kind of looking for a bit more hope. Yeah, going through it. Yeah.
And what do you think that people might think about adding some extra type of testing into the test that we currently are able to do, if it gave us more or less, in, you know, more information about somebody's risks of developing symptoms?
In terms of what is, would it be just the same blood test, but you would just be running more trials on it? And so if it would just be more, in my opinion, if it's just more blood or whatever you need from me, then it's, I don't see the issue of you having to run more tests on it. I think it's really important. I'm, as I said, I regularly attend all of my appointments for HDM. I'm more than happy to give any sample that you want from me. I think it's very important as someone who's going through it to be very open-minded and trying to help the science as you're going. So for me, I wouldn't have had an issue with you wanting to run as many tests as you want on my samples. I think it's, if it doesn't change the way that you're having the genetic test anyway, yeah, it doesn't, I don't really see that it having an impact on us as terms of patients.
But what about if it told you that your risk was earlier, or your risk was going to be late, you know, your onset was going to be earlier or your onset was going to be later?
I think in that terms, then you're going to need more sort of counselling support in terms of the genetic counselling. I think in terms of your well-being, I do think that there's going to be more associated risks in that respect. I don't think that perhaps 3 genetic counselling sessions in the UK is enough for, if you're going to know if it's earlier or later. But you know what, looking in a positive light, I think for me, if that there was a case where you could say, oh, well, you know, it's going to happen day dot, I think that it would give me a hell of a lot of an easier time of like time framing and stuff, you know, for my life, things that I want to achieve and do, because I mean, I've got dreams and aspirations to achieve. So yeah, it would have, yeah. Does that help?
That's really helpful. That is
you know, very interesting area, actually. And yeah, maybe I could just, I mean, Nayana, you've mentioned this to me before, is that maybe 10, 15 years ago, it was sort of common practice not to discuss really the CAG repeat length with individuals when giving test results. So you would say, you know, it's a positive test, it's a negative test, and maybe leave it at that. Whereas things have changed now towards giving as much information as you know. So you would maybe pass on the repeat length and say that you know, we can't make any predictions based on this, but your repeat length is 42 or 44, whatever it is. So I was interested, Rhiannon, in your opinions on this, I guess. And I mean, I know you have your own personal opinions, but you've spoken to others as well, I think. But how would you feel about that? Because I think some people want to know a lot of information as much as possible, and others maybe don't.
Yeah, and I think it's got to be a personal choice in that respect. I think going through the process, perhaps on like a first genetic counselling meeting, then you sort of discuss, well, how you would feel knowing more or knowing less, and having those sort of counselling sort of sessions about that. But I can see what you're saying. And like, I know people who are more sort of, okay, I've got it, I don't want to know anymore sort of thing, or I don't want to know if I've got it. And that's perfectly acceptable. Everybody's different. But from my perspective, I'm very much, I want to know it all.
I think from an advocacy perspective, that's spot on, because I think it's information is power. And so it's important to empower individuals to be the controller of what information that they're ready for and the time that they're most prepared for. And I think right now it's, there could be an argument of, you know, what does that change if I'm positive or negative, and how does that, or positive, and what those CAG numbers look like, because there is so many unknowns. But if there could be a treatment, we're understanding that further analysis of those genetic modifiers, then you may have some people who switch. But I also think that it also is still, even with that treatment, that there will still be a big community of people who just need to take the time and analyze and get that information when they're ready.
Yeah. It's definitely going to have to be a conversation for the person. It's going to be individualized, I feel. Yeah.
And we know that, you know, 80% of people still just choose not to have a test for Huntington's disease if they're at risk. And I suppose, you know, part of what I was asking was, are the 20% of people who do choose to have testing, are they the people who want all of the information, or actually within that, are there people who, you know, want to have some vagueness about what's going to happen in the future, because that, you know, that helps them to sort of live the life in the way that they want to, you know, in the way that they want to? Or, you know, are the people that we are sort of, well, that do go through testing, are they the people who, you know, absolutely want to have every single piece of information? And I think you're right, it's a completely individualized thing, and that makes planning things for doctors quite difficult. But actually, you know, it's really important that, you know, especially in a condition like Huntington's disease, that we have the time and we're able to sort of give people the time to make the decisions that they need to make for them.
As healthcare professionals, we're all aiming for a holistic approach and an individualized, best patient-centered care, aren't we? So it's very much, I know what we're all up against it in terms of what we can do with our organizations and our NHS, etc. But yeah, I think it would have to be individualized. That's what we're all aiming for, isn't it? Yeah.
Well, this has been a fantastic conversation, and I love the different perspectives and questions back and forth, because I think it is so important to include the community members as well as advocacy, as well as the scientific partners. So just as we wrap up, what are some ways that people can continue to learn more and stay engaged in these important topics?
Well, there is, you know, there's always articles coming out on websites like HDBuzz, and sort of, you know, engaging with HDYO and your local Huntington's disease associations. I think that they are the best places to find information that is tailored to where you are, but also in an understandable way, because lots of the scientific presentations, and I'm with you on this, Rhiannon, and I understand maybe the first 5 minutes, and then I'm slightly confused by the end of it.
Yeah.
So, you know, I think it is difficult sometimes when you're listening to a scientific presentation or reading a paper. And I'm hoping that, you know, actually there will be some more research into what people might want, or how they might want this sort of information to be given to them during genetic counselling, and hopefully we'll be able, you know, hopefully that will happen too.
Yeah, fingers crossed for sure. And again, I think it's really important that as you're engaging in different in-person events or virtual events, to have these conversations with our scientific partners and bridge that gap, because that clear communication back and forth and sharing your own opinions really matter, because just like we've been asked of Rhiannon today, I'm sure that Tom and Noina are going to take that information back and really consider it and use it to ask more probing questions of other community members as well as to other scientific partners. So please, you know, cross that line, have those discussions, because it really, really does matter. And look at participating as you can in different observational studies to share your input, as well as to contribute to important research that's happening on the back end that can have real impact for future trials and therapies and treatments. Well, thank you all so much for taking the time today to chat with us. It's been a really interesting and important conversation to have, and we look forward to continuing to talk about this important topic and in others through our Breaking Down Barriers series. And at any point, if you have questions, please do reach out to HDYO or anybody that is in your support group, local associations, genetic counselors, neurologists. You have a team of people always around you who are there to support. So thank you all so much, and we'll see you next time.